Today I'm going to talk about what is a Sone, and my goal for you is to intuitively get there on your own. I'll talk about some light history, but you really have to understand it to understand what a Sone actually is and how it's being calculated. I will start by saying that a Sone is a way we can measure subjective loudness of a sound. Subjective meaning it's based on the opinion of what people hear rather than what is actually being heard. This video is designed to be interactive, so I recommend you have headphones or some nice speakers, and some sounds may be loud, but I will try to warn you before those happen. I want to start by playing two different signals, and my goal for you is to focus on the loudness. Now this might be a bit loud, but let's take a listen. So here is signal one. And here is signal two. Did one of them sound louder than another? Let's take one more listen. The interesting part is that these signals are exactly the same amplitude, but I'm willing to bet that many, if not most of you, perceived a loudness difference. But what do I mean by saying they're at the same amplitude? Most people familiar with sound will have probably heard of a decibel or a dB, but many people don't really know what it means beyond the fact that it is a unit. And to understand what a Sone is and why we bothered creating it, I want to tackle what a decibel is first. First of all, sound is measured in pressure. It's the force of the air molecules pushing from one another to form a wave, which we are able to perceive through some pretty remarkable human anatomy in the ear. Pressure is usually measured with the SI unit, pascals. But what I want to do is create a noise level meter from low to high to see how the pressure changes in pascals. So first up, I'll start with the quietest sound I can think of, a soft whisper. This has a pascal unit of 0.000063 pascals. Next, I'm going to go up to something quiet, maybe like a bedroom at night, and we've gone up another order of magnitude, about 0.0006 pascals. If I do a moderately noisy environment, like a classroom, maybe 0.006 pascals. Something noisy, like inside of a car, 0.06 pascals. Something very loud, like a heavy truck, 0.6 pascals. And then something painfully loud, like a jet taking off, is about 20 pascals. Now, you'll probably notice that these might sound like they're going up linearly to a person, but if you look at the pascal values, they're going up by orders of magnitude every single time. And if we convert them to be dB, we get something that's more comparable like this. And here's why we use decibels as a scale as opposed to just pascals. Suppose I have two sounds and I have measured their pressure with a microphone. One says 1 pascal and one says 0.1 pascals. If we were looking at these sounds on a linear axis, I might just think that one of these is a tiny small noise and you probably wouldn't even hear it because there's such a large difference between them. Maybe I would think that this is a blip. Let's take a look at what happens when we convert this to the logarithmic unit, decibel. Now we can see a much easier comparison between the two sounds, where we might not have thought that there was anything there before. And for what it's worth, humans hear logarithmically too, so dB is a nice unit to use for sound. If you want to calculate dB, it's 10 times the log of the pressure measured over the pressure reference, squared. If you don't like working with squares, you can use some logarithm rules and simplify it to 20 log times the pressure measured over the reference pressure. And it's important to know that when we're measuring sound, pressure is an RMS or a root mean square quantity, and the pressure reference is 20 micropascals, which is actually the quietest sound a human can perceive. So dB is a nice unit to use for sound, but it's not a perfect unit. And it's definitely not a perfect unit when we talk about how humans hear loudness. And I can show you this by running a quick experiment. So get your headphones ready. I'm gonna play two tones. They're all at the same frequency, but at 1000 Hertz. And I'm gonna slowly increase the volume until the second tone sounds twice as loud as the first tone. So my first tone is 1000 Hertz at 60 dB, and my second tone will be 1000 Hertz at 61 dB. Let's take a listen. Did you hear a difference? You shouldn't have. Most people can't really detect a 1 dB difference. Now we'll try the reference tone at 60 dB and 63 dB. Okay, here's 60 and 65 dB. And lastly, here's 60 and 70 dB. which set sounded like a doubling of amplitude? I'm willing to bet most of you said either 60 or 65 or 60 and 70, with the majority probably guessing the latter. And you'd be right. 10 dB, depending on the frequency, is usually perceived as twice as loud. But let's take a look at the raw amplitude. So if I have a waveform and I double the amplitude, I'm going to get a 6 dB increase. But I doubled the loudness and amplitude, isn't that a 10 dB increase? Well, it turns out the way that people hear sound versus what's actually being played is different. So a doubling of loudness is typically about 10 dB, while a doubling of amplitude is about 6 dB. Now at this point you might be thinking, why would we need a Sone when I know that 10 dB is perceptibly twice as loud? Can't I just use that? Well, yeah, for some cases, but for most cases it also heavily depends on the frequency. Also, 10 dB is logarithmic and doesn't translate to a perfect doubling of amplitude as we mentioned, so it's not a great indicator for loudness. In fact, decibels by themselves are not an ideal choice for describing human perceived loudness. Any ideas what we would use instead? If you guessed Sone, that's a positive sign. Remember those two signals I played in the beginning? Well, they had the exact same decibel value. But for fun, let's take a look at their Sone value or their subjective loudness, the way humans hear it. We can see that the first signal had a Sone value of 19.4, and the second signal had a Sone value of 24.2. Even though they are the same, we hear them differently, and the second signal has a higher subjective loudness than the first. Now, I did this on purpose because I've picked specific frequencies that sound louder to people. We'll go over those in a minute. And I keep saying subjective, and the reason for that is that every person is going to perceive sound differently. Everyone hears sounds differently. You may be wondering, how did we come up with a way to arbitrarily define how loud it feels like something is versus how loud it actually is? In the 1930s, two Bell Lab engineers, Harvey Fletcher and Wilden Munson, were the first to tackle the problem of human hearing at different frequencies. Oh, and a side fact about these engineers, Harvey Fletcher also developed the early hearing aid and invented the machine that tests human hearing called an audiometer. You've probably taken the test in school as a kid. Anyways, these researchers ran an experiment in where volunteers came to a soundproof room. The engineers played a tone at 1000 Hz as a reference, and then another tone at a different frequency, but the same sound level. Volunteers were then asked to indicate when the two sounds appeared equally loud. If the participants didn't think they were equally loud, the engineers slowly turned up the volume until the participants said they were. Now, I've simplified the experiment quite a bit and I've taken some artistic liberties, but this generated a landmark paper in the sound community because nobody had really looked at what we called psychoacoustics before this, which is the combination of psychology and acoustics. They started by finding the quietest sound people could hear at each frequency. This is called the human hearing threshold. Then they moved up and found the curve where everything sounded like it was at 20 decibels. They repeated it again for 40 decibels, and so on and so forth, until they ended up with a set of equal loudness curves. Now, calling them dB curves got confusing, so Stanley Stevens, who we'll talk about later, decided to come up with a new unit called a phon. And a phon is basically the name of the curve where everything sounds equal along the curve with a reference to 1000 Hz at that decibel value. So for example, the 20 phon curve, everything sounds like it's at 20 dB at 1000 Hz. These are the original curves from the 1930s. And this part is pretty critical since it's ultimately from these curves where we get the idea of what is a Sone. So I'm going to explain these equal loudness curves first, because at first glance they can look pretty confusing. Here at the equal loudness curve, anything that's along this curve will sound the same at different decibel values. And here I've got the axis labeled SPL for sound pressure level. So for example, to get a sound at 20 Hz to sound exactly the same as one at 1000 Hz, it needs to be played at 100 dB versus at 60 dB. That's a 40 dB difference for all my math people out there. So we're just so bad at hearing these low frequencies that we really have to amp them up before they sound equal in loudness to these higher frequencies. Here's what the modern curves look like. These are the ISO curves that we now use when we're talking about equal loudness curves. So the bottom is the human hearing threshold, and I want you to hold on to that because we're going to get back to it in a bit, but I'm going to focus on the 60 phon curve. And for fun, we're actually just going to repeat the experiment that Fletcher and Munson did in the 1930s. So here's another warning for your audio. I'm going to play a tone at 1000 hertz at 60 dB, and I'm going to play a tone at about 125 hertz at 60 dB. Did those sound equal? Maybe not. Now I'm going to repeat this again with 1000 hertz at 60 dB and 125 hertz at about 75 dB. I'm guessing those sounded probably more equal to you. And that's basically what they found, is that anything along that curve has to be at a specific decibel value to sound equal to the 1000 hertz reference tone. Now let's go back to our curves, and I told you to hang on to that human hearing threshold, and it's got some interesting stuff about it, so I want to talk about it a little more. Here is the human hearing domain. Everything in yellow is outside of the domain, so hypothetically speaking, we probably couldn't hear it. Now this doesn't go for everybody, people hear things differently, but on average, anything in this yellow hashed area is not really going to be audible to the average person. Anything above 20 kilohertz is considered ultrasonic. So if you were unfamiliar with where that term came from, it's beyond the human hearing capacity. Now I want to run another experiment. Here I'm going to play a tone, increasing it in frequency from 50 hertz to 1 kilohertz. This is going to be at the exact same sound level, but what it will probably sound like to you is that somebody is slowly, slowly turning up the volume. That's a good example of why we hear low frequencies different than high frequencies. The reason for that is probably just how humans developed. So human music tends to have a range from about 100 hertz to about 10 kilohertz, but human speech is really focused in the 200 to 5 kilohertz range, with 1 kilohertz being sort of the center. And that's probably my theory on why humans are most sensitive to 1 kilohertz or 2 kilohertz. It's because that's where a lot of human speech takes place. And fun fact, the shape of this equal loudness curve, that human hearing threshold, is actually where we get the A-weighted filter curve from too. So if you've ever heard of A-weighting filter, which is a filter that mocks how humans hear sounds, it comes from the equal loudness curves. It's technically the 40 Fons curve. Engineering microphones that you would use for a sound test hear everything perfectly or flat. Each frequency is heard exactly the same. People, on the other hand, don't do that. We've been discussing that. So the A-weighting curve is used to adjust microphone recordings so that they sound more like how people hear them. And once again, that A-weighted curve, that comes from these tests that were done in the 30s. Now, I know you've probably been yelling at me that I haven't actually gotten around to explaining what a Sone is, but it's coming. So Stanley Smith Stevens was a Harvard psychologist who actually found the lab of psychoacoustics. If you remember, he's the guy who came up with renaming each curve the unit of the Fon. I like to imagine that one day in his Harvard office, he was trying to come up with a general unit for quantifying a sound. As I mentioned, it's hard to take a general loudness and apply it and make it subjective. He decided to use the equal loudness curves and redefine them into a new unit, a Sone, which would be linear with respect to how humans hear sound. So he renamed the curves again, where one Sone is twice as loud as two Sones, and four Sones is four times as loud as one Sone. And this makes it so we can easily and linearly compare values on the fly, as opposed to using decibels, which don't have human hearing factor built in. According to his definition, he picked the loudness of one Sone to be equal to 40 Fons at 1 kHz, which is just that 40 dB curve from the equal loudness curves. It's important to note that since the Fon scale matches up with dB and not loudness, the Sones and Fons are not proportional. I know, can be a bit confusing, but Fons are just sort of a naming for each curve. And he actually created multiple methods for measuring loudness, most notably Stevens Mark 6 loudness, which was eventually refined into Stevens Mark 7, but there are also ISO methods for calculating loudness for free field and reverberant field, such as ISO 53-2B. And for fun, a German engineer named Eberhard Zwicker thought he had an even better method, so he came up with Zwicker loudness, or DIN 45631, which includes sound masking. But the point is, all these result in the same unit of a Sone. And here's how you can calculate a Sone by hand. I'll leave these up just for reference. If you wanted to go between Fons and Sones, this is available for you. But this unit sort of took off. Lots of industries use the Sone, especially fan industry, so next time you pick out a fan, you should check on the boxes and see if it has Sones on the unit. Now, I want to show you a quick real-world example on how to use Sones. We're going to look at two blenders. So I have Test Lab up with audio replay, and I have two different blenders, Blender 1 and Blender 2, and we're going to be looking at two different values on the graph. One is going to be the dB value, and one is going to be the Sone value. You might want to adjust your headphones again. Here is Blender number 1. And here's Blender number 2. Did you hear a difference? Now we're going to focus on their decibel values only. So this first number over here. I'll play them again. You should notice they're probably around the same value, about 82, 83 dB. For both of them. And as we looked at earlier, you can't really tell the difference between 1 dB. Amplitude-wise, they're the same, but I bet they sounded different. And if I'm willing to bet, I would say that Blender number 2 probably sounded louder, or even just generally worse than Blender number 1. It's because the frequency content of Blender number 2 has much higher frequencies than Blender number 1. Now let's look at the Sone values. So Blender number 2 has Sone values of about 45 Sones. I'll play it again really quick. So we averaged somewhere around 43 to 45 zones on Blender number 2. Let's try Blender number 1. Around 30 zones. And if I wanted to, I could do an average of the zones over time, but just for comparison purposes, we're dealing between 30 zones on Blender number 1 and 43 zones on Blender number 2. Now, since these units are linear, I can definitively say that Blender number 2 sounds subjectively louder, and Blender number 2 is subjectively 40% louder than Blender number 1. You know, it's around 43 zones versus 30 zones. And you might have noticed that. This is a really complicated signal made up of multiple frequencies, but the Sone value allows us to quickly compare the two just using this method. So let's recap really quick. 6 dB is twice the amplitude in sound pressure. So 94 dB versus 100 dB is the same as 1 Pascal versus 2 Pascals. As you can see, very nonlinear, it's a logarithmic unit. It's not really intuitive that a doubling of sound pressure is not equal to a doubling of loudness. And you have to report the frequency if you're going to use a dB method, because it's going to change depending on the frequency. Whereas loudness, or a sone, linearizes the human perception of loudness. So 4 sones is twice as loud as 2 sones, or 30 sones is 1.5 times louder than 20 sones. And it's got that frequency dependency already built in. So thanks for watching. I hope this video was useful. And if you have any questions about Sones, feel free to drop them in the video.